Hi, it's Geoff Chalmers here from discoverdoublebass.com. That is the home of online video double bass lessons. So if you're new to the instrument or if you're more experienced, you want to learn some new techniques, maybe some new repertoire, we have a whole range of lessons, interviews, step-by-step courses, gear reviews. Basically, if you like the double bass, please go and check out our website. And today I'm really excited because I'm welcoming a new tutor to the website, and she is an incredible singer, incredible bass player, and somebody that I've been wanting to get involved with Discover Double Bass for a while, and she's kindly come across to the UK. We've been filming a really exciting course for beginner jazz bass players who are kind of starting out and wanting to get to the point that they can sit in at the jam session and play their best music. And okay, so time to welcome Katie Thiroux. Welcome, Katie.
Thank you.
Well, it's been a really great week. I've really enjoyed putting this course together with you and listening to you play. And we've also been chatting a lot in the car about all the great people that we've studied with. Mm-hmm. And I was hoping that you could maybe share a little bit about really your background and some of the people that you studied with and maybe some of the stuff that you're doing now as a teacher. So do you want to maybe give us a little bit of information about where you studied, how you got into the bass and what mm-hmm. your background is?
Sure, I'll give you the brief history.
Yeah, go on.
So I started playing violin actually when I was four, and I'm the youngest of four kids, and we all had to start playing violin when we were four. And it was literally a Christmas tree ornament. And so the unspoken rule was playing for 4 years the violin, and we did Suzuki method, but I was really terrible. And I didn't really enjoy playing it, but I did it, and it sounded awful, and I wasn't having any fun. So when I was 8 years old, my mom said, "Why don't you try playing the bass?" She plays the bass, my older brother plays the bass, and she said, "Everyone needs a bass player, so you'll always have a job."
That's great advice.
It is good advice, and I was 8 years old, and I didn't really know what that meant at the time. But I never forgot that she said that. And of course, now I know that because everyone needs a bass player. You know, if I have to sub out a gig or something, all the bass players are already working. So you'll have a job. So I started playing when I was 8, and I was really lucky to have a fantastic teacher. His name's Dr. David Young. And I was studying at the Colburn School when I was 8.
Wow.
And my very first lesson, he didn't really say much. He just gave me the bass, and it was a quarter-size bass, gave me the bow. And it just felt right. It felt perfect, kind of like when an athlete throws their first football or holds the baseball bat, and you kind of know, like, oh, I'm finally home. I made it.
So could you already hold the bow? Did you have a bit of...
It was such an easy thing. Like I said, he didn't say much. He just said, hold the bow. You know, it's going that way in my hand, long way. He just said, put it in your hand and just grab it, turn it over. And then we kind of talked about technique after that, but it was so nice to have such a simple teacher and a simple upbringing in that. It wasn't strict technique, you're doing this wrong, you're doing that. It was really all about having fun, and it went from there. So I studied classical bass all the way throughout high school with different teachers. And I started playing jazz bass because still at the Colburn School, I was studying there playing the orchestra. And when I was 12 years old, I was just walking down the hall with my bass. And one of the teachers there, Lee Seacard, kind of like pulled me. He's like, oh, we need a jazz bass player in our combo. And both my brothers were in the combo. They played bass and guitar, so they studied with him. But I said, oh, I'm sorry, I don't play jazz. I need to read music. I'm a classical bass player. But I loved jazz music, and I actually was starting to sing jazz a little bit. So it wasn't like so far off for me. But he said, oh, it's okay. We just learn everything off of recordings. You'll be fine. So it was really, that's how I got into playing jazz bass. I just started playing with kids my age and just learning music from recordings. So I really fell in love with a lot of great music from a young age, like Miles Davis, Lionel Hampton. And then when I heard Ray Brown, it really changed my life. Like,
do you
he
remember
does.
What that first record was?
The first record I heard Ray Brown with was Bam Bam Bam.
Oh yeah.
Live in Tokyo.
You know it's gonna be cool. With a name like that, it's gonna be
cool.
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah, totally. So when I heard Ray Brown, I was just like, wow, the bass can sound like this. And I had heard Paul Chambers and Israel Crosby and all these great iconic bass players, especially those iconic bass lines. But what he did with the quarter note and just with that pulse of the beat really, really changed my life at that point.
Wow.
And then from there, I was lucky to study with people like Kristin Korb in Los Angeles. I grew up in LA. So I just had like this wealth of knowledge around me, getting to go out and see music. And then when I studied with Kristin, actually before that, I was studying voice with a great vocalist, Tierney Sutton. And she was the first one. We were talking about improvisation and harmony. And she said, you know, we were playing to play along tracks. She's like, well, you already play bass, and we're talking about harmony and chords. Why don't you just play the root and then sing all the harmony we're talking about?
Oh, wow.
So it just kind of came out of a way of practice, and then it became really fun, and I really enjoyed it. And when I was studying with Kristin Korb, we were working on transcriptions. I love transcribing bass lines and certain things. And so I had transcribed Paul Chambers' If I Were a Bell from Miles Davis.
Oh.
And then she said, well, now you have to transcribe the trumpet solo line and then play them and then start working and playing on it together. And then you'll just hone this craft. So for me, like, the whole path was really fun, not forced. And the fun part for me was just when I couldn't do something, the fun part was that search on figuring out how to do it and how to really get great at it.
That's the thing, the obstacle is the way. And so often it's in the repertoire that we're playing. If you're working on Ahmed Jamal, Live at the Pershing, mm-hmm. you know, the Israel Crosby, you know, bass lines, and you're suddenly having to learn about, you know, these arpeggios from mm-hmm. a further distance. And,
yeah.
and that's the pathway that helps us move forward. So, I mean, there's quite a lot of stuff I'd love to talk about in there. So as a teacher, when you're meeting these new students, do you think that classical playing is important to jazz bass players? You've obviously, you know, had this really exciting background mm-hmm. where you've been playing classical music, and I'm sure that's helped you with learning your way around the instrument.
Yeah.
But do you recommend that to somebody coming up? Is that, you know, you get a new student, should they do both? Is it part of the journey for everybody?
I think definitely so, to learn how to play classical music and that repertoire too. Just in etudes and scales and loan, like that approach as opposed to only coming from a jazz approach, the classical really helps enhance it. And just, for example, you know, like the bass line on But Not For Me, Israel Crosby, Live at the Pershing, those certain arpeggios starting on there, it's a little bit hard to grasp without ever really learning classical music, etudes, certain exercises and repertoire.
Mm.
So then those little tricks are just already in your hand. You're like, oh, that's just an arpeggio starting from the sixth going down, you
know? Yeah, I know, that's really exciting. And in terms of the jazz teachers that you've had, you mentioned Kristin Korb. I mean, that was an incredibly fortunate experience because, of course, you're both wonderful singers and you're both wonderful bass players. And one thing I haven't mentioned so far is that I'll absolutely be sharing Katie's music below this video. So you can go and check it out. And, of course, we'll share, you can choose a video of Kristin maybe so we can share some of hers as well. But, yeah, that must have been a really interesting experience. How did you get, you know, hooked up with her? How did that happen?
So I went to a camp called Port Townsend off the coast of Seattle, and I just went there as a singer because I couldn't afford to fly my bass up there from California. And it turned out to be a really great experience. It was just with this great vocalist, Nancy King, and Kristin was in the backing band, and it was a really cool camp altogether. John Clayton was there and Bud Shank was there when he was alive. It was like just full of these amazing jazz musicians. And I was just singing the whole week. And then not until like the last day did I tell Kristin, I was like, oh, I play bass too. And then she started making me play in the class, which was great because all the singers sing in different keys. So then I was just, you know, transposing on the spot. And so when I came home, I just gave her a ring and wanted to take lessons. And the same thing happened with Tierney Sutton. I was 12 and I knew she lived in LA and I really liked her singing. So I just called her and said, hey, can I try a lesson with you? And so just kind of having that confidence because I loved it so much. I just wanted to learn more about it.
Do you think it's helped your connection with the instrument? Because we've been here filming this course this week and we've done a whole series of lessons. And we will actually be sharing a lesson on YouTube about singing and playing the bass. But do you feel that it's given you a deeper connection with what you play? Because it feels very genuine. It doesn't feel like there's any filler, you know, particularly when you're improvising. Your lines are so melodic, you know. I mean, is that part... You know, does it come maybe from a place of singing? Is there a relationship there?
It can. Sometimes it does feel like it. I just feel like, especially when I'm singing bass lines and singing solos, it's just so connected. Then, and I can tell, like, sometimes if I'm either practicing or even sometimes when I'm performing, when I kind of lose focus and then awareness goes away, and then all of a sudden I'm like, oh, my bass lines don't sound good and the beat doesn't sound good. And then I kind of just go back to singing it, you know, just lightly on, and it just kind of comes all back together.
So is the rhythm in there as well? Is that part of how you get your rhythmic strength through vocalizing, you think?
I think so too. Like really, especially like when you're walking a bass line, having that deep core and almost like, sometimes I am a little too vocal. Like, you know, sometimes instead of singing, it's almost like a growl, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But just kind of like that strength has to come from somewhere and that sound has to come from somewhere and it's inside of you.
Yeah, absolutely. And okay, so you've talked about Kristin. I'd love to hear about you studying with John Clayton, mm-hmm. because we're both big fans of his music.
Yeah.
And maybe you could speak to us about that experience. I know he's been a mentor and someone that you've been close with, and I'm sure that you've learned a lot from him. Maybe mm-hmm. you could share something that with your, you know, with the audience that mm-hmm. that's really helped you with your playing.
Yes, John is definitely amazing and really wants to give and share this music. And I first met him as a student at a workshop called the Vail Jazz Workshop. And I just had 1 week with him with a lot of one-on-one time when I was a teenager. And that just stuck with me for years. Just things about, like the things I continue to talk about tone production, even simple things we forget about holding the bass. And I really learned how to learn myself and also how to teach. So kind of, why are we doing things? Like, why do I want to play this bass line? How am I going to play it? Just simple things that you don't really think about, but they make your playing better. And he's amazing. He's made me a lot quicker at learning and being able to get my point across musically.
That's interesting.
So, like, when I go to play a solo piece, he really taught me, you have to play that melody so well so that the person who doesn't know anything about music can understand exactly what you're hearing. So if you're playing a solo melody, I want to be able to hear the melody and the harmony at the same time in the most plain way, but then in your own way. So it really kind of like helped me edit my playing, but also really make sure that, importantly, the music is so important, and also we're playing this music not only for ourselves, but for other people to enjoy.
Mm, absolutely, and he's just such an inspiring person. I always think in terms of rhythm and harmony as well. It's just, you know, has such strength to his playing. It's real joy, and I hear that in your playing too, Katie.
Oh,
it's really fantastic. So, what about transcription? This is something that, you know, we get asked about a lot as teachers and students. Is this something that you think is an essential part, an optional part? Is it something you've done much? Mm-hmm. You know, I'd love to hear about your thoughts on transcription.
Mm-hmm. So I love transcribing, and I've done a lot of transcriptions of bass players. And there's a couple reasons. And I think one big important reason is because we want to find out our sound. What is our sound? And I think the best way to do that is to kind of play a bunch of different types of sounds.
Mm.
So you play Paul Chambers, Scott LaFaro, Charlie Hayden, Dave Holland. There's so many different types of sounds out there. So then you kind of build this library of sound and you kind of hone in on what you like. So there's that one reason. Another reason is there's some amazing bass lines out there. And sometimes your head just explodes. I was listening to Gary Peacock play with Keith Jarrett, Now's the Time, and just a blues bass line. And I kind of thought, you know, you've heard the blues played every which way. And then the way he played this. And then there was a recording of Dave Capteen playing a bass line where he did this really simple thing. And I was like, that's so simple. How come I haven't heard that before?
Yeah.
So you're kind of just adding these to your library and getting these different sounds, learning these bass lines. So I really think it's important for bass lines. And then it's also equally important for solos, for me on the bass, to transcribe not only bass players, but trumpet players, tenor saxophonists, just because their range on the instrument is just physically different than ours.
Yeah.
So then it kind of pushes us to do some different things and find out how to do those on the instrument and then put those into our playing.
And how do you go about it? Do you listen to the record, sing it back, try and find out on the bass, mm-hmm. do you use a piano? What's the process look like for you?
Yeah, so like for bass lines, sometimes it's something that I've listened to for a long time that almost, you know, to the point where I can sing it and kind of find the shape on the bass.
Mm.
And for me, sometimes I might just go measure by measure, but I'm with the bass doing it. Or like a couple weeks ago, I was listening to Oscar Peterson with Ella Fitzgerald and Ray Brown, and they were doing Street of Dreams, and the intro that Ray did and the bass line was just so great, just hit me. So I kind of just heard it really fast and kind of did it while it was happening. And with solos, I kind of like to spend a little bit of time with those and really, really, really listen to those, be able to sing those, and then start to do it on the bass and maybe do, you know, a measure or a phrase. But the point is, the more that I do it, the easier and faster it gets.
Absolutely. I definitely find that it's the same experience, and that I can be a little bit rusty and then I go back to it and then you pick it up. It's like any other skill,
I guess, isn't it? Yeah,
exactly. So, okay, let's finish off with a couple of kind of quick fire questions. So you're teaching, are there any specific method books that you use or you recommend or you think everybody should have?
Mm-hmm.
Go on, what's on your bookshelf?
Cool. like anything, everybody's different, and so students learn differently, but I've found that when I really wanted to shake a student up, especially with scales, I'd give him that Reboth book three. I think it's book three, right?
Yeah, I think that's right, yeah.
With like the mountain of scales and different things, because so often we just play the neck. I actually heard years and years ago at a convention, Rufus Reed talk about playing the bass in an L shape. So just playing it across, like an upside down L, and then going that way. So never really playing in the middle of the E, A, and D string. So in that, I remember that I was probably like 15 when I saw that, and I was like, oh, that's right. It does make sense. So then when you get that Reboth book, you're playing everywhere on the neck, on the thumb position, playing scales in all sorts of different ways. So for technique, I really like that one.
Are you using Reboth technique when you're playing regularly, or is this just part of the way that you're learning and teaching?
Not regularly, but some of those techniques, and it's not like they're necessarily his, but instead of practicing scales, you know, in thirds, like that way, practicing scales and double stops, fourths and fifths, because then you kind of check with your hand, you're like, ooh, my fifth isn't really in tune.
Yeah.
Once you play them at the same time as opposed to separately.
Interesting.
Yeah. And etude books, I like those tried and true books, like the Stork Robbie books. Those nice. You can't go wrong with those. Because for me, when I practice, I like to, when I go to practice, I know how much time I have. So if I have 1 hour, I'm going to kind of condense it into something that makes sense. So if I'm learning a song, if my goal is to learn a song, say it's in the key of F, I'm going to start with a scale that's an F, and then I'll go to my etude book and find something that's an F, just so I'm like right ready to go.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
And then also, the Ray Brown book is great.
I love the blues lines in there.
Yeah, see, the blues lines are great.
I enjoy those so much.
Yeah, and with sometimes students, you never know how they're going to learn. Everyone learns differently. So listening to somebody play is one thing. Them writing it down is something else. Then seeing someone else having written down and gone through it is something else. So you kind of never know what's going to work.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I think that's some great advice. And just lastly, okay, we've been working on a course for kind of students who are fairly new to the bass, who are looking to get out there and build their confidence and be playing jazz gigs and go into that jam session, you know, walk through a blues, maybe play a little solo. Do you have, a little bit of advice for beginner students? What's the one thing you think they should be working on that will really help them move forward with their playing? It's a big question.
I think number one, listening to the music. Listening to the music that you love and that you want to play. Because imagine going to practice this stuff without listening to it and then expecting to go to a jam session. Not only will it just be a little rusty, but it'll be so foreign to have a piano, bass, drums, and horns players all around you. So really listen to the music and also play along to the records that you like, because then it'll just get you ready for that space to start to play with people.
Well, I think that's great advice. And thank you so much, Katie. Just before you go, I'd love to hear how people can get in touch with you online. And maybe if you've got any tours or anything you want to share with the audience, let us know what you're doing.
Great. Yeah, you can always get in touch with me on my website, which is katiethiroux.com. I'm on social media, on Instagram and Facebook. You can get in touch with me. It might be a little late, but I'll be there. And I tour a lot through the U.S. and also fortunate right now to be in Europe. So I'll be at the Copenhagen Jazz Festival this summer in July 2019, doing a European tour in November 2019. So I'm out there, and feel free to email me any questions.
And you also have a very exciting jazz camp. Just tell us a little bit about this, because this is something that just sounds like heaven, really. So go on.
Yeah, okay. So I was asked to start a jazz camp with my drummer, Matt Wittick, in Maui, of all places. And so this is where, one of those things where you never know where music can take you. My step-grandma actually moved to Maui a few years ago, and I had visited once, and then I wanted to visit again, and then I thought, well, maybe let me book a gig there somehow. So I booked a gig at the art center there, and it just so happened that someone from the tourism board was there who also works with education, and then just asked if we wanted to start a jazz camp. It was something he always wanted to do. So my point is you never know what's going to happen, who's going to be there. And that also goes to one of my points, is that you never know who's going to be in the audience. Even if you're practicing at home, always start to feel like it's a performance. And if you're on a gig that you don't feel very comfortable with, or you think that the gig is below you, you're below no gig, it's just have fun with that experience and pretend like your mentors are there. That's what I always do, you know. Pretend like you're playing and Ray Brown is there or Oscar Peterson, whatever. And then all of a sudden you're like, oh, wow, that person's, I got to play my butt off today. Yeah.
Well, that is amazing advice, Katie. I think we'll finish on that note because it's just absolutely perfect. And I wanted to thank you for watching at home. And please check out all the links that I've provided below this video. And make sure that you listen to Katie play because she really is a fantastic player. I'm not just saying that because she sat next to me. And we'll also be sharing lessons and a course over at discoverdoublebass.com. So thanks for watching. Thanks for joining me, Katie. And we'll see you next time.